is Phil. Welcome back to the show. I'm here with Drew Dick. No. Who are you?
I'm Christian Taylor. Hey, everybody.
I don't
everybody.
Even
Hi,
recognize
Phil.
You.
I know.
We're officially a Christian podcast again.
Yay! And Sky Gitani, right? That's you.
I am still me, yes.
Yeah, wearing black to go with the festive Christmassy red.
We wanted Christian to pop.
Okay, I'm going to do...
And I do.
I'm going to do a random character and a random theme song just so we can get the...
Can I just randomly say that I missed you guys so much?
We randomly missed you too. Do you have a random character that you would like to hear?
I would like you to hear you do Junior Asparagus.
Oh, Junior, that's not going to work at all.
Come on, you can do
it. Hey, it's a podcast. See, it'll come out. Larry and Junior to me are almost identical.
How about Laura Carrot?
No, those are girls. I don't can't do a girl's voice.
I just want to see you stretch yourself.
How about Agnes?
Mr. Nezer.
Hey, it's a podcast.
What, Agnes?
You know, you do girls.
Oh, it's a podcast. What do you know?
Wow, that was really loud. She's too loud.
You did Nesser, whatever, last week, Junior.
Oh, it's a podcast. What do you know?
What did I do last? Oh, I did young Nezer.
Mr. Nezer.
So I'll do old Nezer.
Hey, it's a podcast. What do you know? Hey, it's a podcast. So there's no video, except there is. Hey, it's a podcast. So lend an ear. The Phil Fisher podcast starts right here. We'll talk to Sky and Christian too, because she came back at last for you.
I sure did.
From the North Pole. Hey, it's a podcast. So lend an ear. The Phil Fisher podcast starts right here. The Phil Fisher podcast starts right here.
All right, Yay. Where did you come back from?
Well, most recently I came back from a very exciting endeavor in Fort Campbell, Kentucky.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
That's cool. And before that?
Well, wait a second. Aren't you going to ask me what I was doing there? Come on.
Am I supposed to?
Yes.
Okay, what were you doing there?
Well, I was on a very super secret project.
I can't ask you.
No, but I'm going to tell you as much as I can.
Okay.
Okay.
You realize people might be listening.
I know. Shh, don't tell anybody this. But I'm working on a film. And it's about military moms.
Yeah.
And so they flew me down there for a whole week to film a story about military moms. But it has a really exciting...
Is it specifically about military moms with really good voices?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I was the star because of that.
Yeah.
Everybody else was just normal moms.
And your red shirt and your fancy
jewelry. Yeah, but there's an exciting ending.
Okay.
There's
but
a
you
really,
can't tell us.
Right,
yet,
but I can't tell
exciting
you.
Ending.
So you're going to have to come
And where
back.
Were you before that?
Oh, before that, I was in Washington, D.C. for Thanksgiving.
For your anniversary? Is that your anniversary?
And then before that. Oh, yeah. And yeah. Well, yeah. No, here's the funny story. Oh,
okay.
My husband took me on a surprise trip. Do you remember me telling you that? And I didn't know where it was.
Yeah.
Well, that surprise trip was to Washington, D.C.
Surprise.
Surprise.
It's
and then a
President
week later,
Obama.
I went to Washington, D.C. again because... My son, Jonah, the special needs son, was in the Special Olympics, and they went to Nationals for flag football, and he made it in the All-Star game.
Whoa.
This was a total first for him. He'd never tried anything, and because of Special Olympics, they encouraged him to do flag football.
Yeah.
He did, and he made it to the National Championships and then made it in the All-Star game. So it was a very exciting thing for him.
That's
and then we
cool.
spent Thanksgiving there. So it's just been a whopper of some exciting months
That's
in the Taylor
fantastic.
Household.
Fantastic. Well, we got a package from some listeners of ours. I'm holding up their picture.
This was right before I left,
If you're
too,
watching so. The video, I'm holding up the picture. It's Brandon and Katie Price. They are missionaries to Kharkov, Ukraine.
Which Happy rioting.
Is, it's near Jamaica.
It's no, right, it is
it's
not.
Like, it's in the Bahamas.
No, it's in Russia.
No, it's not in Russia.
Well,
it's
in
Ukraine.
Eastern Europe. It's near Russia.
It's in the Ukraine is where the Ukraine is.
Do you have to use the proper article there, the definitive
Ukraine.
Article? It's not. It's just Ukraine.
It's the Ukraine.
No, it's just Ukraine.
It's like the Yukon. You don't just say Yukon.
But I think that's a mistake.
You know, we don't have a lot of time to argue about this.
They sent us Ukrainian candy. I'm holding it up. If you're just listening
and
to this,
chocolate.
This is what Ukrainian candy crinkles
and
like.
This is what chocolate bars look like in Ukraine.
And this is called
Shipuki?
Shipushka.
Shipushka.
I think.
It's Shipushka. It's hard candy because life in the Ukraine is hard. I'm sorry, Ukraine.
And you're supposed to let it dissolve in your mouth,
so
apparently.
So you eat hard candy as a metaphor.
We didn't bring the magnets.
Oh, they sent us these really cool hand-painted magnets. Also.
Sorry. So
you
thank
guys,
you.
That was so thoughtful. Thank you.
Brandon and Katie Price. And we'll be praying for you in the Ukraine or the Ukraine, whichever. It's like if you're on an interstate in LA, you're on
the 485.
The 405.
Right.
The 405. Or you're on, but you, do they say the 5? You're on the 5. You're on the 405. Yeah. And in Chicago, you say I'm on 290.
Right.
Not on the.
You drop the article.
So it's all okay.
But if you look on a map,
it's all okay.
Or a globe, it's not going to say. The Ukraine.
Yeah, but are there thes anywhere on the?
Yes.
Say
the United States of America. Actually,
are you
it's just,
sure?
It's just United States of America. But no, there aren't. That's my point. There are no thes.
The Netherlands.
It doesn't say
it doesn't
the.
Say
the.
It doesn't,
no, it's just
it
Netherlands.
Just says Netherlands.
So you can say the if you want to.
We can really say whatever
the
we want.
Ukraine.
Because
I don't
it
like
is the United States,
I don't
and
like
we
the.
Have freedom of speech.
You are anti-the?
I'm
is that what you're telling us?
Yeah, I think it's just Ukraine.
What? Okay, people are not paying good money to listen to us debate about.
They're not paying any money.
Can I say this is the missionaries that sent us that?
Yes,
or do I have to
can.
Say this is missionaries?
You know what I mean. Don't be smart with me.
Okay, I'm doing a book report today, and this is going to be exciting.
Wow.
I'm super interested in this.
Yeah, so I read a book.
It's not biography, is it? Because I know who it would be.
It's not what?
Miley Cyrus's biography.
Oh,
does
this,
she have one
this
yet?
Year it would be.
She should have one pretty soon. You got to strike while the iron is hot. If there's anything I learned from the Jonas Brothers, it's strike while the iron is hot, because you never know when it's going to be all over.
That's true.
You know, speaking of that, Justin Bieber happened to be the most favorited.
Ridiculous?
No, the most favorited Instagram photo with him and Will Smith. I saw that
really?
Today.
Really? Is it the most
of
favorite
the year?
Of the year.
Or just
the
most
year.
Favorite?
It's the most favorite.
Oh, okay.
Of
with
the
a,
year.
With a V. Oh, that's interesting.
Will Smith and Justin Bieber. Go figure.
In the same picture?
Yes, together. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Why
what,
do we
what
care?
Does that say about... That's what I said. What does that say about us?
I don't know.
I don't care.
Why did you even bring it up? Okay,
your
so...
book report.
Okay, there's a guy. His name is Dr. Peter Boghossian.
I like the way you say that.
Boghossian.
And what ethnicity is that? He's not the Ukrainian,
is he? He's a Ukrainian. I don't know what it is. He is a philosophy professor at Portland State University.
That's two strikes right there.
And he is...
Philosophy and Portland.
Is a fairly...
I heard Portland is pretty great.
I love Portland. It's one of my favorite cities, but man, that is a different planet.
He's a fairly outspoken atheist, and he is engaging in the art and or science of helping people lose their faith.
Hmm.
And because he's become so good at it, he has written a book about it.
He's like the atheist whisperer.
You're on a roll today.
I would say he's the atheist Bill Bright. He is highly evangelistic.
Right, evangelistic.
About
he's
atheism.
Proselytizing.
He is and he's training others in a system to proselytize atheism.
Now, what is the name of this book?
The book is called A Manual for Creating Atheists.
Instead of the four spiritual laws, does he have like the four natural laws or the four anti-spiritual laws?
I think it's the four randomly occurring laws.
I like that.
The four self-creating laws,
okay.
Something
okay,
like
come
that.
On, okay, come on, let's get to the meat of
okay,
the message.
So basically, and this is interesting because I wasn't sure what to expect when I started reading the book. He's an epistemologist.
That's a word guy.
No. It's a knowledge guy.
Knowledge.
Epistemology is the study of knowledge.
Is the study. How
okay.
do we know? How do we acquire knowledge? How
okay.
do we acquire truth?
How do we know what we know?
And so his central contention is that faith is a flawed epistemology.
A flawed way of knowing.
Yes, and he basically says we need to get people off faith and onto science and reason
as much more reliable.
Well, that's a typical atheist stance. Of that's this. What they all say.
So I'm getting into this, and it's fun because he will talk about what he believes and what his approach is, and then he will do what he will describe interventions, actual interventions that he has done in the lives of people that are addicted to faith. List the questions he asked and their responses and how many rounds. He's a big fan of the Socratic method, so he asks questions.
Now, explain the Socratic method.
Basically, Socrates believed in teaching by questioning, not by
giving the answers.
Giving the answers.
He was not a didactic teacher.
So what about this? And did you think, and what if this happened? And so he describes all these incidences where he will go at someone, of a person of faith, and try to Socratically call their faith into question and leave them, even if it's only a 90-second interaction at the grocery store checkout, which he described one of those that he did, to try to plant a seed that will undermine their faith going forward.
He sounds like he could be a demon.
Wow.
He could be. That's what it kind of sounds like.
Is he bald?
Like that Satan has sent him around.
No, he has very short gray hair.
Okay.
And he's kind of cool.
Doesn't he sound like a character in the Screwtape Letters?
Yeah, he kind of talks.
He's like a de-evangelist.
He kind of talks. So his biggest contention is that that religious beliefs are delusional and should be classified as delusional. And the three marks of a delusion are certainty, unwillingness to revise, and implausibility. So if you have a belief that is, first of all, highly implausible, okay, I just saw a guy with wings take off and fly to the sun. Okay, that's implausible. Are you certain you saw that? I am 100% certain I saw that. Is there anything that...
You've lost us now because he's opening chocolate.
He's opening the chocolate. I know. Scott.
He's upstaging you. I'm so sorry.
I have this on the table.
I've got a limited
this
amount of time.
All the way from Ukraine.
Have a shikuksi. Have a
shipushka. Okay, you were saying...
So those three things define a delusion. And he says religious faith.
Implausibility.
Implausibility. Yeah. Unwillingness to
revise
and certainty.
Absolute certainty.
Right. Chocolate?
No, I got stuff to do, Sky.
I'm just listening today.
I don't.
Yeah, we're going to listen. Go right ahead.
Okay, so here's some things he says. His first big lecture that kind of put him on the map for, rock star atheists, his first big lecture was entitled, the original title of this lecture was Jesus, Muhammad, the Tooth Fairy, and Other Evil Creatures. And then he said, the organizer of the event politely asked me to tone down the title. So I submitted the following, which was accepted without question. Jesus, Mother Teresa, the Tooth Fairy, and Other Evil Creatures. So, which is kind of telling there, because it's like, okay, just take Muhammad out, replace Muhammad with Mother Teresa, and now we're fine.
That's interesting.
We just don't want to offend one of the groups represented here.
We're concerned about offending one of the groups in particular.
Do you think it's because
when the dentist rise up, then you're in big trouble?
Do you think it's because, no, seriously?
In that case.
We don't want to offend the Muslim faith because they could kill us?
For some people, it's that. In academic circles, I think it's less that than it is Muslims are the minority, and we always favor the minority over the majority. Since Christians are the majority, we'll go after Christians without a problem.
Okay.
When I go through a book like this, I'm looking at a couple of things. First of all, what do I think this person got wrong? But secondly, more importantly, what do I think they got right? Okay.
Okay.
So here's...
You're going to do the right ones first?
No, I'm going to start with the wrong because it leads directly to the right.
Okay.
Here's what I think he gets wrong. Completely wrong. And he gets it wrong in chapter one, and the rest of the book kind of falls apart because this is so wrong.
That's a problem.
He misdefines the word faith. So he starts out by saying faith is an epistemology, meaning it's a way people know things. So, and what he's talking about is people saying things like, Jesus walked on water. How do you know he walked on water? I take it on faith.
Okay, that's what he says faith is.
That's a poor definition.
And if you look in the dictionary, the definition of faith is putting confidence in a person, object, or an idea.
Wouldn't he have looked up that definition?
This has become very popular. Do you want to know how he defines faith? And it's the same way Richard Dawkins defines faith, and Richard Dawkins is one of his heroes.
Okay.
He describes the four big atheist authors, Hitchens, Dawkins, Dennett, and I forget the fourth one, as the four horsemen.
Okay.
So they're the four horsemen of the apocalypse, which is kind of funny because the horsemen of the apocalypse are symbols for evil that men do to each other.
That's interesting.
And he's named his favorite atheist authors after the evil that men do to each other. Dawkins defines faith as belief without evidence.
Right.
You believe something with zero evidence. That's what faith is. Peter Boghossian takes that definition. He says that's his first definition of faith. His second definition of faith is pretending you know something that you don't know.
That's faith?
Yes.
That's
more like arrogance.
That's fraud.
That is one of Peter Boghossian's two definitions of faith. And so his view is that anyone who makes a metaphysical or supernatural claim is pretending they know something they don't know. And the reality is that, okay, if that's how you define faith, then he's right. That is a flawed epistemology.
That's one way to win an argument, is to define the terms in your favor.
Yes.
On page one.
When you start. Right.
Yes. So he clearly rejects any, and this is the other thing, the big mistake he makes, he rejects any historical evidential basis for Christian belief and teaching. He seemingly operates under the assumption that all educated people recognize Christian belief has no historical basis. So you don't even take the time to say, well, why did the people who lived in the first century believed Jesus was who he said he was. You just throw all that out on the basis of, I read something that doubts the reliability of Scripture, or I read something that says it was rewritten, or...
Did he list what his sources were for that part?
No, because that's assumed.
If he's starting from the presupposition of anti-supernaturalism, then somebody can't rise from the dead, therefore belief that somebody rose from the dead
is
implausible. It's ridiculous.
And therefore it's delusional.
Therefore any historical evidence to the contrary must be immediately dismissed because it violates all logic.
So he believes that faith is faith is an unclassified cognitive illness disguised as a moral virtue.
Wow, read that again.
Faith is an unclassified, means we haven't officially classified it yet.
Right.
As an illness of thinking.
An illness.
We need to classify it that way. It hasn't been classified yet, but in our society, it's disguised as a moral virtue. So we praise people for their great faith. We praise them for believing. And he even criticizes, which I also criticize, people who say you just believe because it's important to believe something.
This guy, Mr. Blagojevich here, whatever his name
Boghossian.
Is. Whatever.
I had to listen to his introduction on YouTube to figure out how to pronounce his name.
Okay.
Because it looks
but
like.
But you did that. I applaud your research.
Boghossian.
Does he have pointy ears and does he bleed green?
I said. He seems like a demon.
He seems Vulcan.
Vulcan.
Yeah.
Demon,
you know,
Vulcan.
Like the green bleeding demons of the Ukraine. Okay. So here's what he wants to do. And this is fun. He has a strategy for eliminating faith.
Wait a second. You just told us what he got wrong. Are we stopping there?
Yeah, I'm going to get back to what he got right.
Okay, I'm a linear
later.
Thinker.
I'm sorry.
All right.
Remind me to get back to what he gets right.
Okay.
But here's what he wants to do based on what he believes is true. The purpose of the book is to create what he calls street epistemologists, which is the equivalent of...
I see people doing that in the street all the time. Happens in Lower Wacker in Chicago.
And in the Ukraine.
I'm so glad we kept him around.
Yeah, because we seriously considered it. Just
I know. Mm-hmm.
Out with the bald guy. So we have street evangelists, and we train kids how to... I was forced to do street witnessing in Bible college as a credit.
How'd you do?
Were not.
How'd it go?
The Mormons.
That just seems bad. I wasn't very good at it.
Why not?
What a shock.
You're an introvert?
We were dumped on Hennepin Avenue in downtown Minneapolis outside the bars at night, a bunch of Bible college kids, and now you have to go street witness, have conversations.
If you're going to do it with drunk people. That's the way to go.
Anyway. So he's trying to create street epistemologists. And street epistemologists are people who have in their mind the intent when they see someone or overhear a conversation about faith to do an intervention.
Okay.
And to undermine, to help them lose their faith. But here's what he wants to do, and this is his, he has a strategy for eliminating faith. This is the goal. Nothing short of the elimination of faith as a mental
You should use
illness.
Me as a guinea pig, and we should just go at it.
First of all... He says we need to use the word, and this kind of reveals that he may be aware that he has redefined the word faith. He says we need to use the word faith only in a religious context. So never say, I have faith in the government. I have faith in my friend to do what he said. Never say anything like that.
Oh, so he's saying that his idea of faith is different than the real definition.
No, than the one that a lot of people are using that just confuses the matter.
Okay.
And I can't tell if he's genuine about this or if this is just a strategic move. Because to be honest, you know what he has a problem with. And this is what Dawkins also has a problem with in a number. His problem isn't with faith. It's with the concept of revealed truth.
Right.
It's with the concept that there can be truth that is given to us from beyond.
That we just can't get ourselves.
That isn't measured or
yes,
calculated or discovered in a laboratory.
That you can't discover. It's the opposite of discovered truth. I think that's his real argument.
It's really behind all of that is an issue of control. Because if there's revealed truth, I'm not in control.
Right.
If it's discovered truth, I am in control.
Right.
I was actually going to say that myself.
Which is why all this apology, and you know, whenever I got into these debates, especially as a college student with atheists or whatever, it was never really about any of the issues. It was.
If you say something that's really smart like that, I'm going to give you a shapoopy.
Oh, wow. So we're talking about epistemology and shapoopy.
Oh, I just dropped the shapoopy on the floor.
Wow. Mm,
they have different flavors.
Yeah.
Remember, you're supposed to let them just dissolve in your mouth. Don't
bite
them.
Don't bite them because Ukrainian candy bites back, I think.
I wonder what flavors these are.
It's actually made from leftover Soviet warheads.
Step. Well, at least they aren't in the hands of terrorists.
That's right.
That's all I can say.
Do we know he's
look
not a
this.
Terrorist?
These look like...
Yeah, he looks like a terrorist.
You can
like,
see this.
Yeah.
You'd want to put
What's
these unwrapped
like?
In a dish.
Yeah, it does. It looks like a saucer.
Beautiful. They're like marble.
Those are beautiful.
Yeah. It looks like a flying saucer.
Shapoopies are beautiful.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brandon and Katie.
Let's see if we can talk with them in our mouth.
So now I'm the only one who can talk.
We can talk. We
it just
can't
sounds
talk
very
properly.
Sticky.
Use the word faith only in a religious context. Basically, clear away every other use of this word so you really stand out if you use it.
Do you see what he did here? You were talking, and he
opened
the candies.
I didn't know that you...
The last thing that was said is you said when I was talking to atheists in college, and he totally upstaged
you. And then you put a candy in your
mouth.
But
he did it better than you.
He's using my blood sugar problems against me to silence me. I'm being oppressed.
You were going to say when I was witnessing to atheists in college.
Well, I used to do those debates on campus. I just said when you get down to it, it's never about the argument. It's always about people either want to or don't want to surrender their control to God or someone else.
That makes sense.
I mean, that's core human.
All right, going back.
Back to the book. Number two, first of all, you only use faith the way that he is defining faith.
Mm-hmm.
Don't use it the way it's been historically defined because that confuses the issue. Number two, stigmatize faith-based claims like racist claims.
Oh, I just bit the candy. That was weird.
You bit the candy?
I'm sorry, Phil.
You're not supposed to.
There's a reason.
What?
It feels like I have toilet bowl cleaner in my mouth. It's like...
Now, what should I do?
Like
should I spit it out?
It's like scrubbing bubbles.
Holy cow.
Wow.
You know, I'm trying to accomplish something here. I don't know if you notice where you are right now.
Are we in a podcast?
We're on air.
I got number two.
We're on. What was it?
You know what I meant.
What was it?
Number one was...
He just used toilet bowl and number two in the same paragraph.
Only define faith the way he wants to define.
Yeah.
And number two was... I forget.
Exactly.
Exactly. Stigmatized faith-based claims like racist claims.
Ah, that's right.
I need a Kleenex.
So, sorry, I can't help you. So that eventually, here's what he wants to happen. Eventually, it will be unthinkable to use faith as a justification. People won't even think about using faith. Faith, like the idea that slavery is acceptable, will just go away.
So far, his argument has no logic to it whatsoever. It's all about emotion and marginalization.
This is his strategy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, next, if you wave an ancient text in your hand and expect others to cede to its authority, then you need to sit at the kids' table. He wants people to introduce the concept of the adult table and the kids' table. And if you're relying on revealed truth, you need to sit at the kids' table. Those at the kids' table can talk about anything they'd like, but they have no adult responsibilities and no voice in public policy.
So he basically wants to shame and berate anyone who has religious faith.
If it works. And then continued failure to produce evidence. In other words, support your claim that this revealed truth is true. If you have no evidence that it's true and you continue to fail to produce evidence, that should be met with this statement. So here's what you say, street epistemologists. You are pretending to know things you don't know. Go to the kids' table. This is a conversation for adults.
Wow.
So that should be pretty effective.
Wow, something bubbly and warm is oozing out of the center.
But can you prove it?
Or is if this, I stick it out
are
on
we
my...
supposed to accept this on faith?
I bet if I stuck it out, you could
okay.
see it.
Okay, next step.
It's very invigorating.
Yeah, don't bite.
Next step. Treat faith as a public health crisis. We must reconceptualize faith as a virus of the mind and treat faith like other epidemiological crises. Contain and eradicate.
So what does he think we should do to all of the churches and mosques and synagogues?
Hey, that's a good question, because his point number four, financially cripple all purveyors of faulty epistemologies.
Well, why don't we put every clergyman from every faith and denomination into jail or a concentration camp?
He's not ready to go that far.
Well, that's so compassionate of him.
But all the tax incentive to religious organizations should be removed. That's this point, so that we can financially cripple.
Well, if you really cultivate...
But why does he really care?
Next, create skeptical atheist children. Raise a child so she doesn't hold preposterous metaphysical beliefs.
Haven't all of these things been tried in communist cultures?
Try harder.
And this is exactly what various communist regimes have tried to do.
In communist regimes,
never worked.
Regimes, did they use the analogy of the kids' table and the adult table? Because I think that was what they were missing.
That's what they were missing.
Okay, and then finally, and this one actually made me sit back and go, oh, wow, that's something.
Things that make Phil say,
This one is something. Remove religious exemption for delusion from the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. Okay, the American Psychiatric Association publishes a book, the official book called The DSM, and it basically defines what is a disorder, what isn't a disorder.
I check it every night.
To try to explain what you just said that day. Mm-hmm. In that book, the definition of delusion is a false belief based on incorrect inference about external reality that is firmly sustained despite what almost everyone else believes and despite what constitutes incontrovertible and obvious proof or evidence to the contrary. Okay, so if you say, I am Elvis Presley, and everyone knows you're not Elvis Presley,
then we're going to think you're deluded.
You hang on to that belief and you refuse to consider evidence to the contrary. That technically is a delusion.
Yes.
As determined by the American Psychiatric, which means you can be treated.
Right.
Which means someone can treat you. But
hopefully.
Under that definition, almost every American is delusional.
Because they all think they're
that
Elvis?
That is not true.
Yeah, sure it is, because so many of them are holding out hope for, you know, their sports team or their future or, you know.
But they all don't think
they're buying lotto tickets despite all evidence to the contrary that they're going to win.
I was going to do that today. Is that okay?
Is it contrary to what almost everyone else believes? And despite what constitutes incontrovertible and obvious proof? To the contrary. Okay, so his contention, and this would be also the contention of the four horsemen, is that religious faith is a delusion.
Okay.
That it fits the definition of delusion. But the next line in the DSM
says, the belief is not one ordinarily accepted by other members of the person's culture or subculture, e.g., it is not an article of religious faith.
So
this is called
a religious exemption.
This is the religious exemption to the definition of delusion in the DSM. Because of this, and this is why it really ticks this guy off, he does work, which if he was a Christian, you would call ministry, in prisons, for example. And he actually does research on prisoners about their critical thinking skills and whether a lack of critical thinking leads to incarceration. And can you decrease recidivism if you improve their critical thinking skills, which they've found you can for the most part. What frustrates him is that when he has prisoners who are talking about how they've now found Jesus in prison, which he says is very common, he is not allowed to try to persuade them that that's a delusion. That's unethical. It's classified as unethical.
Among the inmates who find Jesus in prison, what is the
recidivism?
Recidivism rate. Is it better or worse than those who simply find atheistic logic?
That's outside our book study.
I don't have that.
All right. Outside the
book. He didn't put that in his book, but he doesn't care because all the four horsemen will tell you it doesn't matter if it benefits your life. If it is false, you should reject it. It is not a defense of holding a falsehood simply because you got benefit from the falsehood.
I would actually agree with that.
I tend to agree with that, too. So he wants to remove the religious exemption for delusion from the DSM. If this were true, he says, it is crucial that the religious exemption for delusion be removed from the DSM. Once religious delusions are integrated into the DSM, entirely new categories of research and treatment in the problem of faith can be created. These would include helping children who have been indoctrinated into a faith tradition, and legitimizing interventions designed to rid subjects of the faith affliction.
He's got a point there.
Which one?
Well, in his tactic. Because it was back in the 70s when homosexuality was removed from psychiatric disorders that it kind of moved the whole agenda forward in making it an acceptable and normalized
thing. So, for example, you cannot commission a research university cannot commission a study on what's the most effective technique to talk people out of religious faith. They can't legally. You know, it's unethical. Because these are the guidelines that say what a group, what a university can study.
Well, why can't there be, there are Christian universities that study the best ways to bring the gospel into a community or population. Why can't they found atheistic universities?
Because it would still violate the DSM.
So?
Well, that's unethical.
Why? On what basis are they declaring ethics if there is no absolute?
These are because you have to follow the DSM you're commissioning research.
Whatever.
Why don't they
get a bunch of atheists to fund it themselves?
So
why can't they get a bunch of atheist
foundations?
Because
he would lose his license with the American Psychiatric Association for doing that kind of research.
But if you believe
it's
true,
your license.
If it's true and it's right, then why don't you do it anyway? So why would a little thing like a license
hold
you back?
He has graduate students working on a plan to change the DSM. And that is actually, it's a little bit scary. Not a lot of bit scary, because I think it's highly unlikely that in a society as religious as America that you could do that. But that is exactly what happened with the definitions of homosexuality in the very same books.
Yeah, but the difference was in... What? Why are you showing that?
The Ukraine wants you to help with their definition of...
In the case of homosexuality, they were taking something that had been historically qualified as a disorder and saying, no, it's not. It's okay to be gay.
Right.
Whereas in this case, he's saying, we want to take something that's currently seen as okay and make it a disorder.
Yeah.
And that seems like a different shift. And in this case, you know, what percentage of the population is seen as or understood to be gay? Is it less than 2%, I think?
Something like that.
So you're talking about opening up, normalizing 2% of the population, and his suggestion would basically make...
abnormalizing
85% of the population mentally, psychologically ill.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I think that's a little bit higher hill to climb.
It is. It's definitely a higher hill to climb, which is why I said it's a little bit scary. I don't think it's a lot of bit scary because I don't think he could pull it off. But it never occurred to me that that was an approach you could take, you know, in where you don't have political will, behind an issue. Another way is to go about it. And I think it shows the gap, the widening gap between the beliefs of the academy in America and the beliefs of most Americans.
Yeah, but perhaps that's true. At least the academy in Portland, Oregon, and whatever university this guy's at.
Well, not, okay, we're running out of time. And I want to know the end game.
Not Notre Dame.
But the
or not.
The question is, why doesn't he mention the fact that there have been cultures and societies in the recent past, the last 100 years, that have tried to do exactly everything he's advocated, but it hasn't worked? And the falsehood here is the idea that if people just think properly, they will act properly. If they just have the right knowledge, they will follow it. And yet history is full of people who knew the right thing to do, even the logical thing to do, and don't do it because we are more than our minds and more than reason. We are also broken, sinful people that do stupid things.
Right.
And what about all the research that talks about when, you know, the people that are filled with, you know, faith and prayer, it does amazing things for the good, like, you know, turning around people's health or, you know, allowing people. Yes.
But if it's a false belief.
He's not a utilitarianism.
He's not a utilitarian. Is stirred, Rick.
Yeah. Pragmatist.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So, like I said, what I think he's got wrong is the big one, that he's redefined the word faith. And he, at one point in the book, he even throws out Hebrews 11:1, you know, it's hope in things unseen. And I worked at defining that in What's in the Bible so that kids would know exactly what it does mean, and that it doesn't mean hope in things we'll never see. It means hope in things we haven't seen yet. It's distinctly linked to the promises of God and people who had been given a promise by God but hadn't seen it come true yet. So they were basing their belief on evidence. God said this, I believe he is. And this is our global definition of the word faith in What's in the Bible is, faith is believing something is what it says it is and that it will do what it says it will do. So specifically, faith in God, and you can't have faith without a subject. You need something that you're having faith in, which is why just using the word faith loose is just bad use of language. Whether you're an atheist or a Christian, faith is not a standalone thing.
Right.
Faith is putting confidence in the representations made by something, whether it's a chair or an airplane or modern medicine or a witch doctor or whatever. It's putting confidence in the claims made by that. So he's just redefined faith entirely, and he rejects any historical evidential basis for Christian belief at all. Here's what he's got right, okay? I think many Christians actually define faith the way he does.
Well, then they're not Christians.
I didn't say that.
I did.
No, you can't say
well,
that.
Well, because if they're saying faith is just this ethereal thing, then it's not a faith in something.
No, I don't think they're saying that, because what he's saying is faith is pretending something is true that you have no idea if it's true or not, that there's no evidence.
And you're saying a lot of Christians feel that way.
When you read,
I'm going to have faith even if I have no idea.
So if they get challenged on, you know, so why do you believe the Bible is true? They say, I don't know, I just do.
I just have faith.
And it's part of two things. Number one, we're really not very well educated in our faith.
That's true.
So we honestly don't know. I don't even know. I just do. I don't even know why. I don't know why.
Which is, I think, part of the reason why so many young people are walking away from the faith. I don't think they're any less Christian than previous generations. They're just less willing to tolerate the nominalism of going through the motions. Right. So,
yeah,
exactly.
Well said.
Thank you.
So we're not very well educated in our faith, and secondly, we're not not many Christians are really good at critical thinking, or rather, flip it around. A lot of Christians are not good at critical thinking, which exhibit A is the number of chain emails from the internet.
Oh, gosh.
I get sent by Christian friends that clearly did not have any critical thinking applied.
Or even tried to research whether or not it was true.
Which is what critical thinking is.
This goes back to Mark Knoll and the scandal of the evangelical mind, right?
Yeah, it does.
Christians over the last few generations have not highly valued academic or intellectual rigor.
I think partly what he's reacting to is the number of Christians that he has either bumped into personally or sees on TV that aren't critical thinkers. The reality is, most people aren't critical thinkers.
Sure.
You know, it has nothing to do with subset of Christian or Muslim or anything.
So
most people aren't really good critical thinkers.
So what does he do with like a Francis Collins or somebody who's very...
Francis Collins is considered a strange aberration. A very good scientist who believes the Bible. You know, and people said that he should, because Francis Collins was nominated by Obama to be the head of the National Institute of Health. He's mm-hmm. now like the leading, he's in charge of all American funding of, government funding of medical research.
And this is the man who led the project to map the human genome.
Yes. Right. Yes, he's very bright.
He's very brilliant.
And he's very Christian. And some people said that should have disqualified him for that position. That he should not have been nominated by the administration.
Because to be a Christian means...
Because he holds supernatural belief, which will affect his ability to do research. Mm. So, I mean, and that's where it's gotten in the academy. Yeah. Like, you, if you believe there is anything behind the curtain, there's anything beyond the reach of science, you should not be in a position of leadership, you know, in the sciences.
Which is exactly what he's advocating culture-wide.
Why does this have to be mutually exclusive?
I think a lot of it is because it has become antagonistic. You know, in other words, we have, in other words, I don't think Richard Dawkins would be as successful as he is if Ken Ham didn't exist. And I don't think Ken Ham would be as successful as he is if Richard Dawkins didn't exist.
We talked this on a podcast.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes. So it's
Jerry Maguire.
You guys are out to get us. So we have to raise money to fight back. And oh, wait a minute. You guys are out to get us. So we have to raise money. So because there are boards of education in southern, you know, rural counties that want Darwinism out of the curriculum, scientists around the world are up in arms and saying right. that Christianity is anti-science, you know, and anti-intellectual, and it's created this conflict. So here's what I think. Want to know what I think? How much more time do we have before you have to leave?
I have 9 minutes.
I don't know, but I'm dying to know what
maximum.
You think, Phil.
Here's what I want to do. I want to encourage parents and Christian educators to teach critical thinking skills.
That's asking
That sounds
too
like
much.
A good objective.
Do you know why we don't do that?
Because it's hard.
Because we're afraid our kids will actually use them.
And they might come to a different conclusion.
And they might come to a different conclusion that we have come to.
Then we're living out of fear.
There's a very interesting article that I tweeted last week about extremes in the homeschooling movement. Mm-hmm. You know, parents that, and it's really abusive kind of cases of homeschooling, kids that aren't allowed any outside contact, you know, and homeschooling is just a part of protectionism.
It's like a bunker.
Yeah, basically it's fear-based, you know, you cannot interact with the world because of this fear that you won't accept the beliefs that we want you to accept.
Right.
Okay, that's the opposite of encouraging critical thinking. Now, what's interesting in this article is that some in the homeschooling movement, because of Michael Ferris, who's the head of the Homeschool League and founded Patrick University, he's been, Patrick Henry University, he's been encouraging homeschoolers to learn forensics and debate so that they can debate the world. And so lots of homeschoolers, they've been developed debating homeschool curriculums. And so homeschoolers are debating and kids are learning how to debate. But what's happening that no one foresaw is some of these kids are using their new critical thinking skills to question their parents' beliefs.
Uh-oh.
And parents are becoming very upset.
Don't teach my children to think.
Yes. Don't give them that tool if they're going to turn it on me. And that's where our fear...
You know, we can do bad things with stuff other than critical thinking. Should we remove those qualities as well?
Like what?
It's been tried in other monastic communities.
What else can we do?
I'm just going to leave it there.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yes. Ethiopian
I was trying
eunuch,
to figure
anyone?
Out what
I'm
to say.
I'm just going down the logical...
Figured saying nothing
would be
best.
If we really want to protect our kids from every... bad thing in the world or everything they may choose which is not healthy, then there's all kinds of horrible
stuff. To me, it is the critical issue because every example that Peter Boghossian gives of engaging a conservative Christian in a debate, it is clear the person he is talking to does not know how to think critically because they can't respond.
Right.
And it's not that their beliefs are false, it's that they don't have the facility to answer what is being asked
sure.
of them.
Maybe we should have him come on our podcast.
Yeah, I don't think you'd want to do that.
We'll put him in a diabetic coma with all the sugar and candy.
I didn't open it. I didn't know. Oh, I opened that. Okay,
yeah,
I opened the Shapoopy. That's a song in the Music Man, you know.
No, I did not.
Yeah, Shapoopy.
I don't remember that.
My daughter's auditioning
Stay on
for
task.
It. Sorry. Okay. We also need to present the historical evidential basis for Christian belief, that it is not, we're just making this up.
It's not just a faith thing.
And this is what it boils down to. The people that followed Jesus didn't follow him in spite of the evidence. They followed him because of the evidence.
Right.
So if, and you can say, yeah, but we believe the historical record of that as passed to us now has been compromised and is no longer reliable. That's a conversation worth having, but it's a completely different conversation than to say you believe that without evidence. Mm-hmm. You can say, I don't like your evidence.
There's also a need to differentiate different kinds of evidence. There is kind of laboratory evidence, scientific evidence, repeatable experimental evidence where you can do something over and over and over again and produce the same result. And then there's testimonial evidence.
Right.
The kind of evidence you hear in a courtroom.
In fact, one of the things that struck me is that what I think he is uncomfortable with or not in touch with is the difference between what you can learn by studying a natural process and what you can learn by studying a person.
Right.
You know, because it, because there's always the desire to see God behaving like a natural process.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so they do prayer studies, these really stupid prayer studies where they do double blind, 100 people praying for people by first names only so they don't know who it, they're praying for an illness on
this
a car.
This is something real?
Oh, yes. Yeah, it's been funded by Christian foundations to see if it worked. Harvard just did one.
Oh, my word.
And they don't work. Because they're treating prayer like a natural process, like you push a button and a biscuit comes out, like a rat in a maze. And I can just picture God saying, "Are you kidding me? Really? Are you kidding? You expect me to jump through that hoop when you ring the bell?
Shall not put the Lord your God to the test."
So God is a personhood. There's personhood, which means you can't learn about God like you learn about gravity. But what that means is there's less certainty. Mm-hmm. You know, there's less certainty in me learning about you than there is in me learning about gravity.
If you only knew.
So my final point, and then we have to let Sky go.
And then you have to sing me happy birthday.
We have to encourage people to become more comfortable with uncertainty.
I agree with that.
Because so many Christians, that's one of his key points, is all these religious people are absolutely certain in their beliefs. They're certain that they know what is right, that they have found truth.
Part of it is getting Christians comfortable with the idea that the number of things to be certain about should be very few. That you don't have to be certain about every last minutia of what your tradition is.
But even the certain things, are you 100% certain that there is a God?
I believe, help me in my unbelief.
I think people would be much more comfortable with uncertainty if they develop the critical thinking skills that you're talking about, because then they will have critically arrived at a place where they could have a conversation about what they believe, and they could be comfortable in knowing what they know and in not knowing stuff.
Because Ultimately, we know nothing with certainty.
That's right.
And the reason we know nothing with certainty is because the only way we know things is through human reason, which we have no way of proving is reliable.
Well,
because all we have to analyze it is human reason.
Here's the other thing. But he's doing exactly what he's accusing other people of, which is saying this is certainly not true. Absolutely.
He's certain about his certainty.
Yes,
he says he's open to his beliefs being changed. But the test, he says, if people ask me, what would it take for you to believe there is a God? He actually borrowed this test from someone else. He admits it. That he would come out one night and the stars would be rearranged to spell out his name and to spell out the name of every person on earth in their own language that they could see at the same time. That would convince him there is a God.
And you know what?
So he's not.
That could actually happen. He could actually have that experience if he was having a delusion. And how would he know the difference?
That's a really good question.
He could be smoking some shapoopy and and have that experience when he walks out at night. We would never know.
I got your shapoopy right here. It's Ukrainian candy, kids. Don't freak out. It is Christian's birthday.
Yes.
Oh, how old are you, Christian?
29.
She's not going to tell us. I'm not quite certain I have complete confidence or faith in that answer, but that's okay. We love you anyway, and we're glad you came back to be on the show today. Will you be here next week?
Absolutely,
I
will.
You won't go away.
Are you certain?
I won't. I'm certain. I'm certain in my certainty.
Again.
Unless I'm not here.
Yay! Happy birthday to Christian. Thanks for coming
everybody.
To the podcast.
Glad to be back.
See you next week.